Hello, everyone. In southern Poland, there was a cow, this cow, who was characteristic for her fierce and relentless resistance on a farm where she was being raised and enslaved to be killed for her body and made into beef. In fact, she was so characteristic, she would always fight back, that the farmer said when it was time to send her to slaughter, he instructed his workers to tranquilize her before they attempted to put her on the track, because he expected something to go wrong. He expected her to fight back and resist, and he was worried that his workers would get hurt. His workers had sent hundreds of cows to slaughter in the past, had encountered many, many who had fought back in that process, but they were confident in their ability that they could force them onto the track with tools like cattle prods and kinds of other horrible things, gates to scare them and to corral them in. So they ignored his advice, and they didn't tranquilize her, and they went to go and force her onto the track. When the track pulled in, she was lined up to go in. They started jabbing her, as they do, to push her on. And what she did is she crashed through the big metal fence and galloped across the field. The workers behind her started shouting and calling, trying to get her back, but she just kept on running, intended purpose to get away. A worker came along to the tree line to try and stop her in her path, and she charged through them, breaking her arm and bruising two of their ribs. She carried them going through the trees, running and running, with again voices behind her calling out her name, until she got to a lake. And, you know, she's there before this large body of water. This is a cow who has never seen such a large body of water in her life. You know, it's completely new to her. She doesn't know what she's really experiencing. But, you know, the voices are behind her and she's being chased and she needs to get away. So what she does is she makes the incredibly brave decision to jump in, and she begins to swim. So she's swimming across the lake, and the workers and the farmer by this point, who has been called over, go and they watch her swimming away. This lake is massive in Poland, and she's swimming along. And the workers and farmers reported seeing her dive underwater for extended periods of time, for about a minute, 2 minutes. And then she would pop up in different places. And it was quite clear that she was trying to go, you know, get away and get out of their line of sight and escape. Anyway, she carried on and she swam, and she made her way to a small island in the middle of a lake where she began to live free. The farmer attempted on multiple occasions to go and bring her back so he would go onto the island and try and get her onto a boat and get her back onto shore. And each time she would move to attack him. So he said, okay, what am I going to do? And he enlisted the help of the fire brigade. And the fire brigade came with lots of fancy equipment, and they took their boat over. And as they made their way over to the island, she kind of was aware of their presence. And when they got off and they unpacked all of their equipment, she responded by just swimming over to the neighboring island. Fire brigade said, fuck this, this is not our job, and then went home, and she carried on. During this time, the media got a hold of this story. It made nationwide news, and then it made international news. She became dubbed by the media as the hero cow. People across Poland, people who, vegan, non-vegan alike, got behind her cause and started calling out for her to be free and to be living in sanctuary. The cause reached celebrities who were going out making statements and writing Facebook posts, and then a local politician got on board and he said she could come and live with me for the rest of her life and she'll be able to live happy and free on my land. And he offered to farm the money to take her on. Bearing in mind that to the farmer, she's worth about 1,000 zlotys, which is about 5,000 zlotys, which is about £1,000. You know, so, I mean, he was, up until that moment, intent on recapturing her so that he could have her killed and to sell her for food. And what happened was they enlisted a veterinarian and four animal rescuers who went over to the island. This time they were a lot more silent in their approach. I'm having witnessed what happened in the fire brigade, and they took with them tranquilizer guns, and they crept through the foliage and snuck up on her, and they shot her three times with tranquilizer darts, at which point she struggled, she resisted, and then she passed out through the drugs going through her system. By this point, she'd been free for a month of her life. They picked up her body and put her onto a truck, which was then going to go and take her to a vehicle, which was then going to go and take her onto a boat and back onto the mainland. But she never made it off that truck alive. When she was on there, she woke up, didn't know where she was, had a heart attack, and died. I just wanted to ask, what would it mean for us if we shared more of these stories within our movement, and if we recognized this individual as someone who were on the front lines of the animal liberation movement, a person who is out there campaigning and fighting for her freedom and for the freedom of other people, if we recognized her as a being with agency, with her own will and desires and strength. And if we listened to her and tried to understand what it was that she wanted, would things be different? Would we be different in the way that we speak about other animals? At this moment, I'd like to just propose that we take a minute silence to remember her and to remember all of the other animals who are born into and suffer in captivity, who resist and fight back, who suffer and die. Animals who live free in the wild, who have their lands colonized, and who resist and fight back against that also. Animals who liberate themselves and are successful in gaining their freedom, who now live in sanctuary or free in the wild. And the possibility that these animals' freedom can bring to all others. Thank you. So this talk is on animal resistance. It's on all of those times and more that animals fight back, all of the stories that we never hear, all of the ones that get reported on in the media, and all the ones that will never be, because they're done by small animals whose resistance isn't significant enough or noteworthy enough to be in the media. There's a quote here which was from an Irish traveller in the early 1900s, and it reads, "These cows seem as rebellious to their owners as the people are to their kings." And this presentation aims to show that resistance is not only a human concept, but it exists across all species. This is a small baby rhino named Arthur. Arthur was in South Africa, living in the savannah with his mother, walking through, likely enjoying the sun, having a nice time. And out of the distance came approaching a jeep that was driving through in their direction, leaving trails of dust behind them. Seeing the jeep, Arthur's mother tried to remove themselves and get to safety to get away. But by the time they had been spotted, the three men on the jeep pulled out guns and quickly shot her dead. Arthur began circling her, nuzzling her, wondering what was going on. And as these men approached with their machetes, with the intention of taking the horn off of her, He is a small, a four-month-old baby, stood in her path and said no. He just, at most, he said, you're not coming back, you know, as you do, stand there strongly, you're not passing here. So what they did is they took their machetes and they attacked him as well. Rescuers came and found Arthur lying there, dying next to his mum, but they were able to bring him back to sanctuary and he recovered. And he now lives in an animal sanctuary in South Africa. I just have a question. Having heard the story and seen what Arthur did in response to his mum being mutilated and killed, I would just ask, does Arthur have a voice? Yes, no?
Yeah.
Yes. It is an extremely common narrative in the animal justice movement to say that animals are voiceless, to say that they have no voice, to say it is our role as humans to speak up for them, because they do not speak for themselves. But as we saw from Arthur, they do have voices, they are speaking. And in a fantastic book called Beasts of Burden, a woman called Sonara Taylor writes this quote, which I'm just going to read to you at length. Animals consistently voice preferences and ask for freedom. They speak to us every day when they cry out in pain or try to move away from our prods, electrodes, knives, and stun guns. Animals tell us constantly what that they want out of their cages, that they want to be reunited with their families, or that they don't want to walk down the kill chute. Animals express themselves all the time, and many of us know it. If we didn't, factory farms and slaughterhouses would not be designed to constrain any choices an animal might have. We deliberately have to choose not to hear when the lobster bangs on the walls inside a pot of boiling water, or when the hen who has passed her egg-laying prime struggles against the human hands that enclose her legs and neck. We have to choose not to recognize the preference expressed when the fish spasms and gasps for oxygen in her last few minutes alive. And Arundhati Roy, who writes in the context of in post-colonial India, and looking at people who are oppressed there, saw this same narrative of people being called voiceless, who are actually marginalized and silenced. And what she says is there's really no such thing as the voiceless, there are only the deliberately silenced or the preferably unheard. And that is what I suggest the animals are. Now, the exploitation of animals and on any oppressed group fundamentally rests on the silencing of their voices. It fundamentally rests on us not hearing their perspectives. Because once you begin to hear the perspectives of an oppressed group, then that stands too big of a contrast to what it is that we're doing to them. Once we hear the perspectives of people suffering racism, sexism, that stands as a fundamental challenge to our ingrained superiority, to the violence that we perpetrate against these communities. And so it is the role of us as animal justice activists to stand in solidarity with animals, and what that means is to elevate their voices, to bring their voices to the forefront. It's not to bring our own voices to the forefront, it's to bring theirs. If we're being interviewed by the media, if we're talking with friends and families, to bring their perspectives and their voices to the centre of the conversation and bring them in. So we're not two individuals having a conversation about what's right and wrong, it's about bringing that voice in. And this is what all solidarity movements seek to do, looking across all social justice movements, to bring the perspective of the marginalised and oppressed into the conversation. And we do it and it's extremely effective. I mean, who of us cannot connect to what we see here? Yeah! so powerful is because animals speak with utmost clarity in these moments. There's no. When you see this video with the sound and all, there's no mistaking what's happening here. There's no mistaking that this is someone who is trying to defend someone they care about. It's just absolutely clear. So, during moments of resistance, it's with utmost clarity that animals speak. And so it's a perfect opportunity for us to bring in these stories to communicate how we think and feel and to really challenge the pervasive violence in society. Animal resistance also, through bringing their voices into the conversation, leads us to review other practices we do and other things that we're debating about and the ways that we relate to animals. So there's a common debate that goes on in kind of animal rights communities and environmental communities around conservation. Is it right to intervene in the natural world, in animal families and communities, for reasons of conservation? You know, one of the ways that we intervene is to go and sedate animals and then to, you know, measure them and understand, you know, what their population sizes are and what their diets are like through going and interfering. One of the ways we do that is to go in, sedate them, take them away, give them horribly traumatic experiences. And what do the animals have to say about that? Well, this is the result of in this helicopter, when it was up in the air, was a man with a tranquilizer gun who was attempting to shoot an elk. The elk responded by jumping up and booting the helicopter, causing it to crash. And this is the wreckage that was left. Both people in the helicopter did survive. However, the elk unfortunately died in the incident. And I'd say that pretty much stands on the comments of what the animals feel with respect to those practices. Animal resistance also challenges what human ideas of animal freedom is. It's a common narrative that the end goal of the movement is for all animals to be in sanctuary. But what is a sanctuary? Bear in mind, before I say anything, I'm totally in support of sanctuaries. I think they do absolutely vital work, and they are filling in a gap of providing care for animals who are, in many instances, unable to live because of our urban societies and so on, and they rehabilitate animals. But they are essentially still in an enclosure. And what do animals say about that? So let's have a look. So this is taken from a sanctuary in Italy. The other one wasn't thinking about too. And they're out. You know, this is, you know, living in a small square for your entire life is not freedom. And actually speaking to many sanctuary owners, and having spoken to sanctuary owners, and when we posted up this video on the Facebook page that I run called Animal Resistance, sanctuary owners commented and said, thank you. This is not the end goal. We believe in creating the society beyond the need for sanctuaries. We aim to create a society where sanctuaries are no longer needed and we can live in multi-species community where we can live harmoniously together and animals can be free, not kept. It's like this is a stage towards liberation, it isn't only liberation. So we have to be careful using those kind of narratives. Spin it on switching between PowerPoint videos. But there's not many more videos. And animals do often communicate a strong desire to live free and not on farms and not in sanctuaries. And we see this with a cow here in Poland. Does anyone recognize this image? Has anyone seen this before? You have? Cool. So this is a cow in, it's Poland again actually, this is a cow in Poland who escaped from a farm and went to live with a herd of bison. And they accepted them into their community, and she has been living there for, well, I think a couple of years now. Still living there, I think. And yeah, just living free. This is a cow who has rewilded herself. At the time when I saw the story about this, scientists wanted to go in and take her out and bring her back into safety. And they were saying, oh, she can't possibly live out there, she's not going to survive. And so, you know, they were going in and trying to impose paternalistically, actually in the interest of her own welfare, you know, to take her out. But she, you know, quite clearly chosen, her community had chosen for her to be there, and yeah, she lived for a very long time. And that's pretty much, I'm pretty sure she's still there, having a nice time. But it's important to recognise that, of course, she is an individual and that was her choice. Not all species want to do this, not all individuals within species want to do this. The key thing is listening to what individuals want, which is a no-brainer really, but we forget that when it comes to animals because we just see them as cows. At the end of the day, they are individuals with their own personalities. So I'm not saying that this is the end result for everyone. Some animals might want to live in a sanctuary. Some animals might not. Let's just listen and come to know them and their personalities and what they would prefer. Looking at animal resistance also deepens our understanding of animals. So we get to see their cognitive abilities, like quite high level cognitive abilities that they're not generally have attributed to them. We've seen some stuff that's indicated high levels of cognition. What we see with this story, so this is a tiger called Tatiana. She was raised on a zoo, or animal prison, where she would live out her life being, gawked at, pointed at, laughed at, insulted at times, you know, having her privacy constantly invaded, which, you know, would be an absolutely terrible life. One day, we had three young men, young teenagers, who came and, you know, they were just causing a nuisance in the zoo, really. They were going and they were abusing lots of the animals and shouting horrible things at them. And they went over to her enclosure and they shouted things at her. And then they was wandering off. And her response to what was on that day to jump and climb up a 12-foot wall of her enclosure and go out onto the grounds. And she went and attacked these young men. One of them she killed that day, and the other two then got away. She then went around the grounds and ignored every single person that she saw. She didn't, everyone she saw, she just walked straight past. And she was searching for these other two young men. And then she found them hiding in a cafe, and then she went and attacked them again and injured them. These other two young men thankfully didn't get killed. But her, on the other hand, was shot dead by the people working in the animal prison. What we see here is, one, just a heartbreaking set of events that comes, that, you know, is, you know, her whole horrific life living in this prison, these young men who have been raised to be speciesists in this horrible society that teaches us that animals are less than and that we can treat them in that way. So then that incident happening and then her taking revenge. But what we also see is the ability for revenge, something which is so often denied to animals. You can never say that an animal can do a premeditated attack, because that's anthropomorphizing animals. It's treating them as if they're human. But very, very, very clearly from her behavior, she was doing clear acts of revenge. She didn't attack anyone working at the zoo. She was only seeking out these young men.
What was her name again, sorry?
Tatiana.
Tatiana.
Another example location is, so this is southern China. A dog, street dog, was, you know, China's very hot, and they often look for a nice place of shade to sleep. And a street dog had found a car that they could crawl into and sleep on the back seat. And had a very nice, lovely nap. And then the guy came and found his car, found his dog in it, and then pulled the dog out, kicked the dog, and then the dog ran away, scared and with their tail between their legs. They then went to their other friends that they probably was running around with and living with, communicated in whatever way they do what happened, came back later on in the day with a whole pack of them and attacked the car. And they just did this for ages, and they, you know, just bit the hell out of it. You know, this is a dog going and organizing collectively to go and take action against an injustice, which is what we do, which is what probably a lot of us do if we're in this talk engaging animal activism. And we see that, and we should be celebrating that, and we should be talking about that and sharing these stories and being inspired by these stories. Now I want to move on to kind of strategic opportunities that animal resistance presents for us as animal activists. So this is an animal called Chautauqua, who was a horse in Australia who was raised and enslaved to be a racehorse. They were a champion. They had won the Melbourne Cup many times. When they were forced to race, they had amassed for their owners millions of dollars worth of prize funds. They were a famous horse. They were doing this and forced to do this for many, many years, until one day they said that they had enough. And what they did was just refuse on 7 consecutive occasions to race. You know, all the horses are there with the riders on their back and with the reins standing at the beginning of the race. The doors open, all the horses are kicked, and then they go off. Chautauqua 7 times in a row refused to run. World champion horse. So this is something that started making national news, international news. It was a big discussion. This was last year, this was happening. Has anyone heard this story? So international news. And then what happened is the basically the racing authority said that, you know, she's going to have one more chance to race. We're going to do a test with her in 1 month's time, and if she doesn't run, then she's going to be retired. So retiring means that she's not going to be forced to race anymore, not that she's going to be killed. So they went away and they brought in some guy who they kept totally secret, who they brought in to come and train her secretly in a secret location, using, you know, whatever tools they use to train horses, which often can be, you know, domineering and aggressive tactics, often with a little bit of kindness as well, but all in a manipulative way to get them to be broken, as they call it in the horse racing profession. So they tried to re-break Chautauqua so that she would submit to human control. So she went through 1 month intensively of this rehabilitation, I think they called it. And then she came back on the fateful day of August the 28th, I think it was, last year. That may be wrong. And this is what happened. So we normally hear like the... So we have the guy, if the sound was on, talking about, because all eyes were on Chautauqua at this point. So he's wondering what's going to happen.
And we're about to find out the future of the modern day Boomer of Australian racing, Chautauqua. Elite break in. Here we go. And he stood there. He didn't come out. He refuses to leave the barrier. Tommy Berry has given up on him. Chautauqua is still.
Let's just quickly see that again. the tape. You know, this is someone who's lived their life being forced and told what to do by a human. Just imagine how many people actually can stand up against such a strong oppression? How many people in history do you know that have taken such bold stances on their own? Like, this is a powerful, powerful individual. And this is someone who we should be inspired by and should be sharing their story. And, you know, this is, you know, being who we often call vulnerable victims, but this is certainly not someone acting like a victim. And so strategically, okay, so this is happening. And I had a look at what was going on in the activist scene of Australia at this time, how they was responding to this unfolding story. And you had one organisation doing stuff, the Coalition for the Protection of Race Horses, and they were kind of using Chautauqua as an outreach tool, and kind of speaking about her as the horse who's refusing to race, and it was, you know, excellent that they actually were out there sharing the story. But there was so much more that we could have done. You know, this was an unfolding story that the press attention was very, very strongly on. Like, I'm sitting there and I was contacting people in Australia, so I used to be in Australia, and I was saying, hey, you know, if you're over there, this is time to go and do direct action. This is time to go and block up the racetrack and demand that Chautauqua be sent to sanctuary. So Chautauqua to be free, to go and demand that and cause disruption around that and make Chautauqua a symbol in the movement to end horse racing and to end other forms of animal oppression. Because once you've got this kind of attention on an issue, you know, you had the like people across the nation of Australia and across the world who had picked up on this story, empathising and sympathising with her. And when it came to this point, people were hoping that she wasn't going to race. You know, people were with her. So there's so much energy there to capitalise on, but it just kind of went, and nothing was done with it. And I thought that was a great shame. And so this is part of what we're doing with animal resistance, is saying, you know, let's take these opportunities that animals are presenting to us, and not only because it's strategically important for animal liberation, but also because this is what solidarity is. Solidarity is standing with people in resistance and elevating their voices and helping them in their journey to freedom. And you know, from this, you go on the news as an activist and you go from the conversation about this individual horse to the whole issue of horse racing, then to the whole issue of animal exploitation. And very quickly take an interview where they're talking about this one instance to, you know, generalise it across the whole thing. And then transform consciousness in the moment. Sorry, but yeah, as I said, we don't treat animals as these powerful beings of agency. What instead we do, and this was said by quite a prominent activist who I'm not going to name, because it's said by so many of us that it would be unfair to name anyone, and said by myself up until about a year ago. How can we use our own pleasure to justify our ruthless dominion over the most vulnerable on earth? Like, this is the narrative that we have, that they're vulnerable, that they're victims, not that they are actors in their own liberation, not that they're fighting for their freedom. And it changes how, you know, the public will view them. If we change the frame from most vulnerable to those who are fighting for their lives on a daily basis. And so now this leads me to question this whole phrase, vegan for the animals. And I asked, do we really want to be doing it? Like, is what we're doing, are we doing it for animals? What does it mean when we say we're doing something for the animals? Has anyone ever thought about this phrase before, this phrase that we use so often? For the animals. What if I was to say I'm feminist for the women? How does that sound? Good? No? No? Okay. No one wants to date me after saying that? No. I mean, what would be a better option? I'm feminist in solidarity with women? Probably would want to get rid of that as well. Yeah. So, vegan in solidarity with animals. Which means I stand with them. I don't stand for them. This isn't a paternal relationship. This isn't me as a saviour. With my human supremacy. It's like, what I'm saying is this, for the animals, for the women, it's still a form of supremacy. It's assuming a higher pedestal than them. It's part of our ingrained speciesism. A question a bit more, so the vegan society, so what does vegan mean? So the vegan society defines it as a philosophy and way of living which seeks to exclude as far as possible and practicable all forms of exploitation of and cruelty to animals for food, clothing, or any other purpose. So, I mean, what is this? It's about a philosophy. It's about me, right? It's about us. Veganism is about humans and what we do, what our behaviour is. But do we want to be making the movement for animal liberation about us, about our actions? Or do we want to be making it about animals? Suppose we have an anti-speciesist movement where we are standing in solidarity with animals because we're against speciesism, because we're against a system of oppression. We're not asking people to take on an identity. We're not asking people to take on this identity of vegan. We're asking people to recognize that movement is already taking place, that people are already fighting back, people are already resisting. Let's just stand with them and join them in their struggle against speciesism, against the system of oppression that sees them as objects, as commodities, and will see their lives as worthless. So I propose this instead, anti-speciesist in solidarity with, I put it under animals because we are also animals. I want to talk about a story where I've seen solidarity done very well. So, does anyone recognize this elephant here? Has anyone seen this photograph before? Famous photo. Yeah, so this is about 20 years ago. So, this is an elephant who was called Tyke. They were born in 1973, captured from the wild and brought over into the circus where they were enslaved to perform tricks. And, you know, in their life, you know, they were abused, they were ridiculed, they used this thing called a ball hook, I think it's called, where they kind of, it's like a spiky thing where they jab the elephants so that they, you know, stand up on their back legs. All these horrible things done to them for their entire life, her entire life. To the point where she, on a day when she was performing in public in Honolulu in Hawaii, fought back against this and just had enough, and she attacked the her trainer, who was known to have abused her over time, and she attacked her trainer and someone else sent in, and she attacked them as well, both of whom were trainers and both of whom had, you know, she would have experienced direct violence from the second person who stepped in, she ended up killing. And then she ran out into the streets whilst people screamed and ran off, not knowing what to do. So she tore through the streets of Hawaii. On the way, she was just crashing cars as she went. She would knock down fences, like, you know, intentionally. She was like, she was going on a rampage. And it was such a painful thing to see when you see the videos of this. It's like you see someone who's so much in pain. And what people described is, like, you know, after she had done the act of killing, after she had attacked these owners and killed one of them, she kind of stood there in the circus and she, like, the people described it as almost witnessing, like, an oh fuck moment, like, I'm not coming back from this. And then that led her just to run off and just start going on this rampage. And so, anyway, she ran through the streets. All the police were called out, and also all the media came along. And so, all this stuff was being filmed and being broadcast live on television. And then the police ended up surrounding her in this moment and shot her 88 times. And she died in the street. In response to this, activists came out in absolute outrage. And they, the next day, and censored her resistance and used her as a symbol. Even though it was like, you know, it was absolutely tragic what happened, but it was absolutely tragic to what happened to the person who died as well, and her person, and also the trainer who died. You know, someone who had been raised to think that was okay, and that was, you know, a species of society. It could have been any one of us doing that job, you know, if we were born into the right environment. And, you know, since Type's death, all of this campaigning has led to the banning of the use of wild animals and circuses in over 20 countries and in over 300 cities. And this can all be traced back to this, because it was after this that the movements went boom and all over the world, thanks to Type.
That was
1994, the 20th of August 1994. So, thinking about the kind of narratives we can use when we're looking at animal resistance and the kind of ways we can use this strategically to benefit animals and stand in solidarity with them, there are a few. So, there are other animals who liberate themselves from spaces of oppression. These are the beings who escape. A fantastic example of this is Rita, who jumps from slaughterhouse trucks. She was a pig who was pregnant with babies, and so she jumped off the truck. We're often seeing mothers, pregnant mothers, are the ones who most often jump from trucks. It's a pattern which I'm really starting to observe as I'm collating these stories. Recently, it happened with a cow called Brianna. In America, who jumped from a slaughterhouse truck, gave birth 2 days later to her baby Winter in a sanctuary. And now they both live, mother and daughter, in a sanctuary when they were going to slaughterhouse. And the guy, Animal Rescue Control, who was called out to this incident when she was on the highway, has started campaigning off his own back. He's not vegan, he's not an animal rights activist, he started campaigning against the slaughter of pregnant animals. So, you know, these things, they generate emotions and actions in people. Animals liberate each other. I really wish I had a picture of Fred, because Fred's awesome. Fred's a goat who was in an auction house, going to be sold, and he escaped the auction house, broke through the fence, and then he was living free. And periodically, every few months, he would come back and to the place where he was escaped from and come and headbutt the gates, breaking the gates open so other animals could escape. And he did this multiple times, you know, and I'm pretty sure we're still out in the wild. I try and follow up on these stories, but it's hard after the original story to know what's happened. Animals protecting their habitats. So in, I forget which country it is, it was observed gorillas going and breaking traps. So they were going and smashing out the traps, and they were working together in these clever ways where they could do it with one of them. You know, they figured out the system, they were going and just smashing them up. And we so often, you know, like activists are celebrating when we as humans go and do this, you know, hand stabbing, like, you know, it's got an energy about it in the movement, and we love it, we get off on this stuff. But I've never seen one hand stab group ever share this story of animals stabbing themselves. Like, yeah, it's fucking awesome. Animals resisting human colonization. So what we're seeing, particularly in Africa and Asia, like particularly in India, we're seeing this, is as places are expanding and poaching's happening and there's encroachment on territory, we're seeing lots of elephants starting to come and they come into communities and destroy croplands, destroy homes, attack people unannounced. And so it's become so common and so pervasive that it's being recorded as an international statistic. HPC, human earth and conflict. This stuff's happening so often. We're seeing the people who are writing about this stuff are saying that it's like they liken it to indigenous people's struggles. You know, indigenous people resisting and fighting back against the colonization of their lands, and this is exactly what we're seeing with elephants. So, you know, environmental movements can use this stuff. Animal resistance can be used in environmental movements and other social justice too. Animals collaborate with us when we rescue them. So DXC did a great story of this where they rescued a dog and they depicted in the video how the dog remained silent as they took her out so that they wouldn't be discovered. Like, she didn't bark, she didn't do anything, she just remained quiet as they took her away. Humans collaborate with other animals when they escape. This is what we do when we go and stop the hunts, right? When the foxes, they're already trying to escape, they're already resisting. We just step in, help facilitate that, get in the way. So we should be showing that as a collaborative exercise rather than just us doing something. It's like we never talk about the animal's resistance in that, really. It's always the friends of the humans and the actions of the human. Humans provide conditions for animals to liberate themselves. When people go into fur farms and they open the gates and then the minks go out and run off free, like, all the humans do is this. They're not picking up the mink and taking it away. The minks are straight out there as soon as they can. But again, we focus on the action of the human. And animals passively resisting. So this is just, you know, foot dragging, refusing to work. It's just like the small, tiny things that they're doing constantly, and they are doing it a lot. Last time I gave this talk, I got through it quicker. New forms of protest animal resistance offers a support network, so we can create, you know, a network of sanctuaries that's working to take in animal refugees who have liberated themselves and encouraging the sanctuary movement to develop and using their sanctuaries to tell stories. Mobilizations to stand in solidarity when individuals are rebelling, and creating networks where we're prepared and ready to act when you see that happening. Like, you know, we've got all our materials ready, we just need to, you know, change it up to the context. And yeah, taking that resistance and articulating bigger demands from it as well. So, you know, the ending of farming or whatever. So, quotes. Until the lion has his historian, the hunter will always be a hero. So let's tell the stories of animals. I run this Facebook page up here, Animal Resistance. We're sharing these stories daily from around the world. If you see any, please send them in. Often we try and share happy ones as well, where it's resulted in them living safe and free. And yeah, our idea behind it is to try and change the culture of our movement, to center animals, to recognize them as beings of agency. We were very much inspired by this Italian page called Resistenza Animale, which means animal resistance in Italian. The Italian anti-speciesist stuff is great, right? They're way ahead of us in England. Sadly, like, the literature is in Italian, so we're bringing the ideas over as much as we can. And let's take inspiration from animal resistance.
That's the riot dog, isn't it?
That is the riot dog. Yeah, the Panicos of Greece, who went to every single riot that was going on. He loved it. Let's build a movement for animal justice. You know, animals are fighting for their lives, they're in an emergency situation. Let's take inspiration from that. Let's recognize that they're rebelling, and they actually have a right to rebel, because they are being oppressed and they are being excluded from having their rights recognized in society. And let us take that right, and let us extend it to ourselves and say, actually, you know, we have a right to rebel. We have a right to stand in solidarity with them, and we have a right to take disruptive and powerful action to make change in this society. And so the work of Animal Think Tank is about trying to figure out how we can do that most strategically and most effectively. So if you're interested in the work of Animal Think Tank, I have a mailing list here. I don't know where the pen's gone. I'll find a pen. And sign up.
Can I just ask a quick question?
Right? Yeah, I'm sorry that it hasn't been much.
Very, very interesting.
What time is it? Sorry.
10:30. Very, very interesting talk. I really find it very fascinating. You've done a lot of good work. But I can think that if it's a path you go down, you might come to a conclusion that's slightly troubling. And that is, obviously, in nature can be cruel. There are a lot of laws, not the laws, carnivores. But if you take that too far, will people, like us vegans, start siding with herbivore animals against carnivores?
Yeah, I think the whole animal rights movement can risk that as well. And I think it's just about creating that distinction and practicing non-interference, which is kind of part of the point of the elk. And yeah, recognizing ecosystems as they are. I've run out of time, so I'm sorry. So I can't question. If you want to talk to me afterwards, and do sign up to our mailing list. We have a training course in August 10th and 11th in London around how to build a mass movement. And we're going to be doing loads of stuff thinking around speciesism and strategies and whatnot. So thank you very much.